Hi, and welcome to this installment of Bergeron Briefs. My name is Art Bergeron. For those of you who haven't seen this show before, I'm an attorney at Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us at Myrick O'Connell. I do nothing but elder law. The purpose of this show is to supplement the seminars and other educational things that I do for seniors by helping you meet the people that you ought to know if you're a senior, and help you understand kind of what's coming or what people are looking at in terms of improving your lives and helping you stay home, helping you live your life as well as you can live it for as long as you can live it. And a person who does a lot of that work is Beth Sulzberg, who is here with me today from Jewish Family and Children's Services. So Beth, thank you very much for coming. And I know that we met not that long ago at your wonderful offices, which are close by. They're right over in Waltham, right?
That's right.
And when we went over, we were talking about some of the issues. I was not aware that Jewish Family and Children's Services has such a focus on helping seniors and helping seniors who may have some issues. Mm-hmm. So can you just kind of talk about Jewish Family and Children's Services a little bit, kind of where you are, who you are for people who haven't heard of you, and then just talk about some of those programs?
Absolutely.
How's that?
And thanks so much for having me on as a guest today, Art. It's really a thrill to be here. So as you said, Jewish Family and Children's Service is not far from here in Waltham. And we are a multi-service lifespan agency, meaning that we have programs for parents with very young children. We have programs for young adults, adults, middle-aged adults, older adults.
So that pretty much is everybody.
We pretty much cover everybody. Our services are for people of any background, any mm-hmm. culture, any faith. And we do a lot of different things. I work in specific with older adults, and particularly with individuals and families who are living with Alzheimer's or a related disorder.
I see. Alzheimer's or other things that cause dementia. So
exactly.
You're always focusing around folks who may have dementia-related issues?
That's my area in particular, yes.
That's got to be a pretty growing area.
It really is. It's remarkable. The biggest risk factor for developing a condition that causes dementia is age. And right now, people age 85 and older represent the largest segment of our society in terms of age.
That is this kind growing. Of growing in terms of
right.
fast growing.
Exactly.
Yes.
So this is something brand new. This is something our society has not experienced before. And this pattern is consistent across a lot of the globe, that there are more people aging than there are babies being born in many countries. So it really means that it's important for us as a social service agency, but also as communities, to think about how we respond, how we make sure that our communities really work for the needs that more and more people have.
And it's funny, I was just reading over the weekend this wonderful article there was a term called orphan elders. Mm. Elders who are, and this is gonna be more and more of a phenomenon, people that are coming up that had no children, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or that had just one, and now because of just geographical jobs and things, there were just literally nobody around. So the society in which there were a bunch of kids to deal with these issues mm-hmm. is really yesterday's society and is definitely not tomorrow's society.
Mm.
So dealing with that's gonna be a real challenge. So that's a huge set of issues to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
Have you folks at Jewish Family and Children's Services focused on particular areas that you're trying to deal with around that issue, or can you kind of speak to that?
Sure. Well, I manage a program that involves two specific offerings
mm-hmm.
that address some of those needs. And
mm-hmm.
then I work a lot to collaborate with other organizations, which we can talk about too. But I run a monthly evening group for adults whose parent or parents have dementia.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting what you brought up about the orphan elders. And as you mentioned, there are also a lot of families where there might just be one child. A lot of the people who come to our group are either the only one who is involved with an aging parent or parents.
Oh, and by the way, is your group all children or is it children plus spouses of folks that are?
It can be spouses, it can be in-law. Yeah. Sometimes people are there because they're supporting an in-law
as well. Interrupt.
That's a good clarification. And in some cases, there are several siblings, but there's one kind of designated caregiver.
So, a designated daughter.
That's its own particular type of challenge.
Yeah.
So that's a monthly evening group that I run with one of our care managers. Mm-hmm. And then also every month we host a memory cafe, which is a social program for people living with dementia due to any condition, mm-hmm. and family members and friends. And it's a new model. It's something a lot of your viewers might never have heard of, but it's one of the ways that people in organizations like Jewish Family and Children's Service are really working to make support available more in the community. So, you know, our memory cafe is a place where you come and there's music, there's refreshments, there's lots of smiling volunteers, many of whom are from Brandeis University, because they co-host it with us.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
That's great, because they're kind of down the street.
They're down the street. Yeah. No one asks what a person's diagnosis is. You know, it's really meant to be a way to sort of go to the neighborhood coffee shop, but with some built-in support to make it really work for people who have dementia.
And how long has that been running now?
Just 2 years. And our cafe was...
That's a while.
It is, yeah. Yeah. It was the second memory cafe in Massachusetts. The first is the Create a Better Day Cafe in Marlborough.
Oh, it was my friend Tammy Pozzarichi's Create a Better Day. Yes.
Yep.
Yes,
so
yes.
Tammy was our state pioneer in starting the first memory cafe. And I learned about what she was doing and about memory cafes in other parts of the country and was very interested. And that led to starting the cafe at JF&CS. And what happened then was that so many people contacted me, mm-hmm. were curious, what is this memory cafe thing? You know, maybe we want to start one. So I started a network called the Percolator, which gets together every quarter, and we just help other organizations share ideas, help other organizations to start and sustain memory cafes. And now there are, as of March, there will be 13 in Greater Boston, mm-hmm. and there's a bunch that are in the works. So I'm hoping that in a year that number will double at least.
And does the Percolator include folks from just the Greater Boston area, or is it throughout Massachusetts?
It's pretty much Greater Boston, because it's hard for people to come too far for a meeting. There is a woman starting a memory cafe in Falmouth, and she has valiantly made the drive to Waltham a couple of times. And I've actually been doing trainings around the state, mm-hmm. for people interested in starting memory cafes. I was out in Springfield and I was in Plymouth, and I said, you know, you all should start memory cafes, but you should also start your own networks to help the cafes coordinate and support one another, because we're just too far away.
So tell me more about kind of how yours works. Mm-hmm. Like, how many people tend to show up? Yep. What tends to happen? Mm-hmm. What time of day does it occur? Some good stories, some not so good stories. Mm-hmm. You know, what tends to go wrong? Because people may hear this and just go, "This could never really work." If you could just kind of talk about that would be great. And then, if you could go from there to, now that you've been talking with this people from a bunch of different places, maybe you could give us a sense of how those may differ, right? Mm-hmm. Or whether you've seen models now that you think may be of real interest and that may complement yours or whatever.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'll describe our cafe and what actually happens on a cafe morning.
Yeah.
And then I definitely want to come back to your question about different models, because there are many different cafes and they're each unique. They're as unique as the neighborhood coffee shop. That's part of what makes it wonderful.
Which is fun, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So our cafe is usually on the first Friday morning of the month. We mm-hmm. have one coming up on March 4th. Mm-hmm. Occasionally we do it on a different Friday if there's a holiday or some other reason that we have to shift it. It's from 10 to noon. And what happens is folks arrive at JF&CS in Waltham. They come up to our conference room, but we've transformed our conference room to make it look more like a coffee shop. We've got our checkered tablecloths out and lots of nice refreshments and coffee and soft music playing. And we have lots of friendly volunteers and tables set up. And so we just encourage people to come in and make themselves at home. Mm-hmm. And we have regulars who've been coming month after month for quite a while now. And they are wonderful about taking first timers under their wings and being friendly. So the first half hour is really informal. People just arrive, they get some coffee, they sit down and chat.
And you've got, you say it's checkered table, so it's a bunch of different tables, so there isn't, people can really kind of mingle comfortably in a small scale.
Yeah. Right, and I tell our Brandeis volunteers that it's like hosting a party. So their job is to be on the lookout and see if anybody looks a little lost and maybe that they need someone to talk to and to go over and sit with them and introduce themselves. And we have table tents on each table with the topic of the day, which is just a conversation starter. And that's an example of something that we design with dementia in mind. So rather than being a question that requires someone to remember something, especially something that happened recently.
That would be a conversation non-starter.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. So they are questions that are much more universal, and they're pictures too. So even if someone isn't really comfortable with language at this point, there's something they can respond to. And we do have people come who have very, very mild dementia, and we have people come who have very advanced dementia. And it all works fine. You know, I think people come in the room, they see people of all ages, they see just a slice of life. And we have worked very hard to make people feel welcome no matter what their needs are right now. So after about a half an hour, then I get up and make some announcements and I introduce our guest artist. And each month we have somebody come, and it could be a dancer or a poet or a musician or a visual artist. We've had storytelling, we've had art educators.
Oh, I see.
And they are not there to give a performance. They're there to share a little bit about who they are and what they do, and then facilitate something that everybody can participate in. And
I
if
see.
People don't want to, that's fine. And occasionally there are folks who prefer to kind of stay in the back of the room where it's quieter and just watch, and that's absolutely fine. But most people really get into it and have a great time.
Now, stepping back to the kind of the theme of the day, so can you give me an example of like what a topic might be, which would have been one of these topics that would be on the on all of the tables?
Sure. So one of them is images of different kinds of food, and it says, what kind of food tastes like home? So it involves the senses. You know, you can look at these pictures and think, what tastes good? And people can, they use that as a jumping off place.
I see.
And it sometimes brings up memories about, well, where were you from? What did your mother cook? And sometimes it doesn't bring up memories. It depends where that person is in their disease progression.
Yeah.
But it's something that seems to open a doorway to communicating for a wide spectrum of people. And we're very careful with the pictures to try to represent different cultures, because one thing about memory cafes is they always wanna be inclusive of different cultures. Because people with dementia, they're living in all cultures, all languages, all backgrounds. So we want it to be an open door for everybody.
Right, and that must be a real challenge in itself. You know, just
although
to some extent, if you're coming in with a limited memory, you're coming in without some of the memories that are bad memories too, of kind of disconnection with other cultures and whatever. So it may be a time that people can be really open to stuff like that.
Yeah, I think that can be true, absolutely. And you know, certainly I feel that it will be a wonderful day when there are Spanish-speaking memory cafes and cafes for other language and culture groups here in our region, you know, that are really embedded in different cultures.
Right. So that people have these real options. Because as you say, so it's almost like there's a set of, I want to say interconnected, but a list of coffee houses.
Yeah.
And a list of different days, and you can go to different places and kind of mix and match.
Exactly. Yeah.
Now, can you talk a little bit more about your artists?
So sure.
Have you found, are there, do the folks who've, you know, with dementia respond equally well to this kind of range of different arts from, you said, music and dance and visual art and a whole bunch of, that's a lot of different things.
Yeah,
right?
I would say everything we've tried has been really well received and a lot of fun. That said, people are individuals. You know, there's a woman who attended the cafe many months and really didn't speak much. Mm-hmm. And it was only after we had a visual artist come and we had the opportunity to each of us make some collages.
Yeah.
And she drew these very detailed depictions of dancers. And we began to get to know that dance was incredibly important to her. So there are particular activities that really are meaningful and special to individuals who come depending on their background.
Right.
That said, I think it's amazing how the creative arts speak to all of us as human beings. And the funny thing that I've found is that sometimes the people with dementia have an easier time jumping in and trying something new because maybe they're a little bit less inhibited.
Right.
And sometimes it's the family members and friends who start off by saying,
like, this is
goofy. Oh, I'm not an artist. Well, that, or right. I'm not an artist, I'm not a dancer, I'm not a singer. And our facilitators, our artists, are really good at, first of all, making sure nobody's put on the spot. So it's not a performance. No one is going to be judged on what they do. And then just really making it so that people can try a little something and maybe step outside that comfort zone just enough that it's exhilarating.
And
I would say every time, within 10 minutes, there are big smiles all around the room. And people who didn't know each other suddenly seem to have this sense of connection.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
It's a pretty wonderful thing. Now, tell me a little bit about the others. As you said, you were number two, and there are now a whole bunch.
Yeah.
So give me a sense of, from your perspective, of whether there are people, whether this format is typically the same format, or whether people are doing other kinds of stuff, whether they tend to be in the same time of day. Just talk about it a little bit.
Yeah. Well, in terms of time of day, one of the things that we've done as a Percolator Network is to make sure that nearby cafes don't overlap.
Right.
Because
you don't want to compete.
We don't want to compete. Right. And in fact, the people who come to a memory cafe and decide that they love this thing, they can now go to one every week, you know, if they live in Greater Boston. So that's ideal. They're all different, and I would say the biggest factor is the location. That kind of leads to many different styles.
Oh, so, I see.
For example,
just the physical
space.
The place is. Yeah.
So, for example, the cafe that Tammy Pozoricki runs in Marlboro is in a house. It's in an old house, and so it's a really intimate setting. You know, I often will have 35 to 50 people in the room. And hers is going to be more like 15 because that's what fits in that space.
Right.
There is a newer memory cafe in Topsfield that's run by a couple out of their home, and it's seasonal. It happens April through October. Oh. And they have built a wheelchair accessible half-mile loop garden. And they have different things blooming every month, and that their memory cafe is for people to come and experience the garden.
I see.
Very different. There are memory cafes around the country in museums, and I know there's one in the works at a historical society that I'm excited to
what
see come online.
What a great location. A society that actually has a historic house or something?
Yes.
Oh,
so,
wow.
You know, if you're in that kind of setting, sometimes you can use the collection of materials as your activity. You can bring things out and look at them. There are several memory cafes in our area that are similar to the one I run in the sense that they have a guest artist of some type, and they spend part of the time doing that and part of the time just socializing.
Now, are there any that are actually in restaurants?
Yeah, there are. Not here yet, but one of the very first in the United States is in Roseville, Minnesota. It's called the
J. Arthur's. Okay.
So maybe long-lost cousin.
I was just reading about this, actually, to get ready for this interview. Right?
Yeah,
and I said to myself, well, that's a natural.
Right.
Because it's 2 to 4 in the afternoon, and what restaurant is busy from 2 to 4 in the afternoon? So it fits right in.
Yeah.
And the space, of course, lays out because it's a cafe.
Exactly. Right? And it's wonderful because I think of memory cafes as really being kind of a gateway between a more formal service, like, say, a support group or a day program, and the neighborhood coffee shop. You know, it's got support and careful design to work for people with dementia, so it's not just like going down to Starbucks. But on the other hand, it's no one's going to ask you for a diagnosis. It's social in nature. So it's not exactly like going to a support group, too. And support groups are vitally important. They occupy a certain role. But people also just need to have fun together. They need to socialize.
Yeah.
And another thing they need, for those who are day in, day out, supporting somebody, mm-hmm. interacting with somebody, whether it's a spouse or a parent who has dementia, they need to have fun together. They need to have activities that are rejuvenating for their relationship, not just going to the doctor, not just dealing with problems.
Right, not just dealing with, and not just being alone in the house.
Yeah, yep.
And doing the kind of the same old, same old, which is very easy to fall into.
It's easy to fall into, it's hard not to, because sadly, there's a lot of misunderstanding or lack of awareness in our society about dementia, and it's so wonderful what you're doing in spreading awareness through your show and through your work. One thing I've heard many times from people who come to our Memory Cafe is that all their friends have disappeared. And it's not that their friends don't care.
But they're afraid.
They're afraid.
And they don't know what they're going to
say. They don't know how to interact anymore.
They don't know what to say.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about, you know, what one of the things that we've been talking about recently, this your interest in going to also kind of a broader model, a so-called mm-hmm. dementia-friendly community model. Mm-hmm. Because when you're describing the cafe, once again, it's really a service that's kind of outside the home mm-hmm. and really designed in many ways for people who are at home, who want to be keeping a vibrant life while they're at home. Yeah. Can you just talk about that a little bit? Because obviously we've had some discussions about it. So.
Yeah, absolutely. So people like me who work in social service agencies and mm-hmm. other health and human service sectors, I think we've sort of had this light bulb go off and realize that we can't start enough programs. We can't kind of do enough of this old style thing to meet the amount of need that's out there.
Right.
We've talked about how there are more and more people living longer with dementia. And for each of those individuals, there's a whole circle of people around them. There's maybe a spouse or partner and children and coworkers and church members.
Friends that used to be there, right?
Exactly.
Friends that are still there. Yeah,
so
yeah.
To the point that just about all of us becomes directly affected at one point or another. So we've really started thinking hard about how do we use our resources to support existing community institutions in being able to adapt and become aware and right. understand and become respectful of the needs of people with dementia. So, you know, how can we provide some education and support, for example, to churches and synagogues and other religious congregations to help them figure out, well, what's happening for their members who have dementia? Are they just kind of not attending anymore?
Are
and
why?
Yeah. And how can we reverse that trend? Because their spiritual life is still important to them. It's just
right.
that maybe they don't feel comfortable or included anymore. How can we, I mean, one group that I have talked to are librarians. They often see people coming in, spending time, coming up to the desk, asking repetitive questions, and they know this person, there's something different about their thinking, maybe they have Alzheimer's, but the librarians haven't been trained to deal with this. So there are so many people who are now interacting with these issues, and if they were given the support and training, then they could make all the difference in those people's lives by
yes.
helping them to stay safe and engaged in their community.
And so how do you deal with that?
Yeah, so what our goal is what you said, a dementia-friendly community or dementia-inclusive or dementia-capable. There are different terms kicked around, but they all really mean the same thing. And I think it's a combination of really spotlighting the great work that's already being done in some communities and organizations that are really out there on the leading edge. And here in Massachusetts, Hudson, Marlborough, and Northborough are working together in a very formal way to become dementia-friendly communities. And they're following the model of many communities in Minnesota that in many ways is a national leader on this work. So that's one approach, is to spotlight and emulate what these kind of leaders on the forefront are doing.
Have kind of been doing,
yeah.
yes.
And another
yes.
way is to try to identify people who are in key decision-making roles and to provide them with some of the tools that are out there and to say, you know, hey, Chamber of Commerce, can you help us get this education out to restaurants in your community to, you know, and there are a lot of different models for doing that. And in fact, here in Massachusetts, there are a number of organizations, including Jewish Family and Children's Service, that are working together to have a conversation among leaders and decision makers to figure out exactly that. What's the best way to move this forward in Massachusetts?
What's the most efficient way?
What's the most efficient way?
Because I suppose when you start thinking about the community as a dementia-friendly community, you just kind of, you start looking about at all the places that that person with dementia bumps into things, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's the bank or the supermarket or the playground or the, there are so many places. And each one of those places probably has a set of almost situation-specific questions that come up, right? So the bank issues are different to some extent from the supermarket issues, right? But each one of them relates to, as you say, you know, a person with a set of who has an illness, who has a set of a set of symptoms, and you're just trying to deal with those symptoms. So that's got to be a real challenge.
Yeah.
Now,
absolutely.
Have you found in terms of starting the work on that have you seen any particular examples of not necessarily whole community-wide efforts, but particular pieces of that pie that where people have been dealing with it, whether it's a supermarket or a bank or whatever, or are you still just kind of learning about that now?
I'm definitely learning about that. I think there's a lot going on that I don't see because I'm not connected with every sector of the economy, but certainly I've met police officers who are really actively working on this in their police force. The city of Boston, the Mayor Walsh has made a big formal effort and has an Alzheimer's initiative. So the city of Boston is training all first responders and
many
other staff. So Boston is certainly a leader in this arena. Just the other day, I was at a meeting of a synagogue in Winchester where the rabbi has decided that this is an important issue to take on for the congregation. And so there's a little committee that's formed to first try to get a sense of what the needs really are and then to figure out what could we do? Maybe some educational programs. You know, there are many possibilities. So I think there is a lot starting to happen here and there. And the challenge, and you described it very well, is that this can feel so huge that it can seem overwhelming. But I think on the other side, it's an issue that most people can relate to on a personal level.
Right.
You know, when you talk about these conditions, it doesn't take long before people say, you know, if not, I've been diagnosed myself, my spouse, my father, my uncle, you know, and so it's not hard for people to understand the imperative to make things better.
To make it better. I know I was looking at an article actually about a supermarket chain in New Zealand, their biggest supermarket chain, that has made the commitment among all of their stores. I think they have 18 stores to become dementia friendly. And there was an interview with the person who was internally who was doing one of it was the person who was doing all of these stores. And he said that he got everybody together. I think there were 18. And so it was the store managers from the 18 stores to talk about this issue. Turns out 16 of them have a kind of a direct connection to somebody who has dementia through their family or a friend or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's so true. Once you bring this issue up,
everybody
knows somebody,
right?
But they're kind of like putting it in the back of their minds because they're, you know, because no one knows what to do.
Yeah.
And I think what you're doing in terms of getting people together to talk about this is great because it just empowers a lot of people to be able to say, you know, we're not going to change the world, right?
Mm.
But we're going to do something.
Yeah.
And to kind of together we can change the world.
Absolutely.
You know?
And it's great to look at the examples of other countries because there are several countries that have been really working away at this for many years. And so that we can get inspiration and ideas. And I also think it's helpful to get inspiration from the disability rights movement. You know, remember how it was when people used to say, curb cuts, you know, what a crazy idea, we can't do that.
We could never afford that.
Public buildings wheelchair accessible, and now it's expected. And so I think there just had to be a shift in thinking.
Yes.
And part of that was people with disabilities bringing their own voice to the fore and saying, you know, I'm just as human as you are and I deserve to have a full life. And people living with dementia are doing that now too, publishing
yes.
memoirs, speaking, being willing to identify themselves as having a diagnosis. And that's really, I think, helping to shift the conversation.
Yeah, it's funny that you mentioned that, because once again, I was also reading, there was a store owner in Cheshire, England, right, who was describing the fact that they had become a dementia-friendly supermarket, right? And he said he likes to think of it in terms of cognitive ramps. He said, you know, it's just taken for granted now that for folks with disabilities who might not be able to walk up the stairs, you always have a ramp to the store.
Yeah.
Well, think about cognitive ramps. Think about store-wide. How is it that you can make the store so that if you have difficulty with your memory, it can be this positive experience?
That's great.
So his example was, so for example, you have to be able to know if you spot somebody who you think has these issues, and the person says, so where's what, I'm looking for this item. You can't say, well, that's row five.
Mm-hmm.
Wrong it, they'll never find row five.
Yeah.
You really need people willing to actually go and really help them find the item. So there's just a million of those.
Yeah, I love that cognitive ramp.
The cognitive ramp, isn't that a great term? Well,
listen,
thanks a million for coming on to the show. I think that people really can be helped and empowered by thinking about these memory cafes and by the work that you're doing to try to even go beyond them. I'm hoping that you can send us or send us your contact information so that we can have a banner. There will be a banner on the show so that if people want to contact you, among other things, because maybe someone around here wants to start a memory cafe.
Absolutely.
They'll be able to do that.
And we have a website on the JFNCS site which lists all the memory cafes in Greater Boston so
That's
that people
great.
Can find them. Yeah.
That's great. Well, Beth Sulzberg, thank you so much for being on the show. Thank you for watching, and I look forward to seeing you on the next installment of Bergeron Briefs. Thank you.